So let's talk about a problem, for example, that originated before birth or through the birthing process. Most people know a cerebral palsy, CP, has to do with a period of anoxy in utero or in the birth canal. And what we find in there is a near-death experience that the child goes through. It's an extremely stressful moment. And you could do miracles actually helping these children after birth to kind of let go of the emotional aspect of that shock that they lived through. It is about, again, being able to tap into the limbic system that holds the whole fascia shut. What you could achieve, you can't predict the very end of it, but you could at least achieve a difference in the way they grow. Because much of what you find is that the muscle of the heart underwent the anoxia. The anoxia produces a reaction of the heart, of the muscle, that will end up with proteinic liquid seeping into the tissue and reacting like glue. So then you have a glued relationship between the heart and the bronchia, part of the lungs. And again, it creates the torque. So then you have, because it happens very early, you have a whole formation of the skeletal system that follows actually that torque throughout the body. You have a typical fascia almost that develops from there. You have the extreme spasticity that sets into the body. Later on, these children get operated on the hips, for example, because the adductors are just too strongly pulling on the hips. The children can't sit in their wheelchairs if it's a stronger form of CP. And this wouldn't be necessary. You can actually go in, you can release that emotional aspect that's still holding the fascia shut. You could open the body up and there is a great relaxation that can happen. You can even help the respiratory tract this way extremely so that the lung function would be bettered. So how soon should you start treating children that may have suffered from anoxia in utero or in the birthing process? Well, sometimes they don't even get diagnosed early on. So if, as a parent, you have the feeling your child is lagging in development, it's kind of floppy, because that is the first period that indicates CP is not a spastic child. First, it's kind of hypotonic and floppy, and the spasticity sets in only later. Try to talk to the pediatrician first, of course. That's the normal way to go, but if you have the impression that your child is lagging development, try to find people that work with integrated manual therapy or have an approach that really goes into the autonomous nervous system to help the child. Times before, when midwives had more of a saying still in childbirth and in the care after childbirth, it would be very common that, you know, you'd kind of help the child to release any stress that may have been held in the body. I call it gymnastics, but it's about, you know, you lay a child down and you pick them up by their little feet and you just hold them, you let them hang as long as they need in order to come through and do this beautiful swan thing. It actually shows that the brainstem is unlocked, because what happens many times, and that's normal, is the more than 80% of childbirth, I would say, the child is left with an impact on C1, C2, because that head going through, having to squeeze through the whole birth canal, it just suffers from that. It's almost a normal occurrence. It's like 80% of children do have digestive issues in the beginning. And for example, the 3 months colics that we know, or GI reflux, the gastrointestinal reflux, have to do with this. There is a whole pull on the food pipe, sort of, so upwards towards the head, because it's held in that position. So in order to help that, there is kind of easy ways to help release that stress and that impact early on.
Early on.
Just this morning I saw that little girl on her dad's arm, 16 months old, and they're saying, well, she doesn't walk well, or she doesn't make any attempt, and I'm just putting my hands on her spine and I can feel there is that impact that kind of affects the whole posture, the whole structure throughout the body into the skull, you know, the plates that don't move properly. So I invited them, asked them to just come over and try that session out, just to help release that pull, that strain on the. So the child may have a reason for why they don't want to start walking on time. So my focus is actually in prevention. It'll be so beneficial if you took the time to kind of start working with your child already when they're really little, and not wait till things really set into the body. What I'd like to show you as a parent is things that you can take care of yourself with your child. A couple of movements, learning something about the meridians, learning to feel, and to help actually yourself and your child with this. So the focus in the work is not to stretch people, to create pain in the body, to go into harsh movements. It's all about subtlety. It's about subtle, diligent movements where you always tune your feel into the body to know this is as far as I can go, and help the child as much as the adult, whoever is the one you're working with, to just release at that point. Anybody could learn it. It's not a miracle. It's about developing your own sensitivity for the body, whether it is the patient, whether it's the person you work with, or your own body.